So, tell me your name.
Put it a bit higher. Take it a bit higher. Huh?
All right.
Is that the highest you can do?
Can you hear the click? Can you hear the click?
No.
Kiara, Iggy, are we live?
All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Hi, hello, thank you for being so excited. You're already standing, can the rest of us stand this morning? Hi. Hello to our online crew. Welcome to church. We can start making our way inside, those guys who are still outside. Yo, I don't know about you guys, but this the end of the year is just like, it's going quick. And I think to remain in touch with what God's saying, what he's doing, to keep our eyes on him in this time is so important. As everything rushes towards the end, I know the students are finishing up exams and many of us are trying to finish projects and different assignments at work. But I think this morning, just as we gather, let's just allow for ourselves to just slow down for a second. You can almost just close your eyes. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that this is your place, that where your people meet, Lord, you are given preeminence. And so we just welcome you here and we say thank you. Thank you that you're faithful to meet with us each and every day. Thank you that you reside within us, that you've made your home within our hearts. And so, Lord, we know that you want to move amongst your people here this morning. We thank you that we can enter in with thanksgiving. Thank you that we can enter with praise this morning. And we just want to worship you, Jesus. Be glorified here this morning, Lord. In intercession, we just really felt that the Lord wants to give us words for each other this morning. So if you know how to share a prophetic word or a picture in a way that is uplifting, that is exhorting of that other person, that is positive. Let's just trust God for words for our brothers and sisters, just as a form of encouraging this morning. Really, in intercession, that was happening quite a bit. So, really feel like God wants to speak in and through his people this morning. And so, if you feel you may have something for someone, make sure that you find them either during worship or after the service. And we thank you, Lord, for this morning. We just say, here we are, just wanting to worship you. Amen.
Thanks, Tian. Good morning, everybody. Yes, let's continue with worship. It's already started.
Your glorious day, you call my name, and now I
is waiting for Tian.
Becoming a jack of many trades with Ange and Craig being away and everyone on leave. Good morning. You guys can take your seats quickly. Can all the kiddies wave at me? Go like so. Hello. You guys can go to Kids Church. So where's our Kids Church leader? We are there. There they are. There's Sir. Go with that man over there. Not yet. Okay. Just now. Okay, you guys can go. Let's give our kids a clap. Okay. Announcements are quite short this morning, but we do have Sifa who just wants to pray with some students. As always, we just want to welcome those who are new. So if you are here for the first time this morning, won't you just also put your hand up quickly and sort of hold it there for a little bit. Welcome, welcome, and welcome. Welcome. It's so good to have you guys this morning. I'm wondering how the number kilo. Oh. So, guys, if you fill in that card in there, you can take it to the coffee shop upstairs and they'll give you a free coffee after the service. We're so glad to have you guys. As always, all our church news is on the WhatsApp group. So there'll be continuous communication there, as well as on our email or newsletter and on the website. So you can see everything that you need to see there. If you need any other information, please feel free to email us at shofaronline, capetownsouth@shofaronline.org. If you scan this QR code now, you can jump onto the WhatsApp group. But that's it from us this morning. Sifa just wants to pray with a few of our students.
Hi, everyone. So today we're just going to pray for some of the students that are graduating this year. And so it's really amazing, but sadly they're going to leave us and they're going to go to the different provinces that they will be going and starting their careers. So just all the students that are leaving at the end of this year, if you can please come up and we can give them a hand as well as they come up. I think university is such a cool experience. I think a lot of us, we grow through university and we get to make friends and everything. But I think what's really cool is that all of these people got to encounter Jesus during the university experience. Like a lot of people come to university and some people I've seen who drift away from the Lord, but they can stand here knowing that they've drawn closer to God during this experience. And I'm pretty sure that a lot of seeds were sown into their hearts that they're going to be able to give to other people to wherever they're going to be going. And we just want to bless them today as they leave. And if Linda can also come up to pray for some of them as well. So you can just stretch out your hands as we pray.
Lord, we thank you for Lisa, Lord, and we thank you that you've brought her into our community during her university years, Lord. And I pray that you go forth before her and every seed that was sown into her heart during her university career, Lord, she can pay that back and sow that into Kimberly where she's going, Lord, and that whatever you have there for her, Lord, that will set her up for the rest of her life, Lord. And there's an abundance waiting for her in Kimberly, Lord. Lord, and I thank you for Fence, Lord, and I thank you. Oh, she's been such a joy, Lord, and I thank you that she's brought such joy to a lot of us and a lot of students, Lord, and I pray that she never loses that joy, that she goes forth, Lord, and that you just fill her up with so much joy in the hard times, Lord, in the being an adult is hard, Lord, and I pray that you just fill her up with so much joy in the little things, in the big things, Lord, and that the blessings never run out, Lord. Amen. Lord, and I thank you for Naomi, Lord, and I thank you. Lord, I see the with her walking into wherever she's walking into, and she just brings this peace with her, this peace that showers over everyone around her, the buildings that she's walking into, the spaces she's walking into, Lord. And I thank you that that peace comes from you, Lord, and that she carries that, and it comes from you, Lord, and then it's this overflowing of peace for her and for the people around her and the new people she's going to be meeting, Lord. And I thank you for that, Lord, and I pray that you remind her of that peace when times get tough, Lord. You bring that peace back into her heart.
Lord, I pray for Millicent, Lord, and I thank you, Lord, that you've blessed us with her, Father. Thank you, Lord, that we've got to see her life, Lord, and just be witnessed by her life, Lord. And I just thank you, Lord, that you've blessed her so much, Father, and that in her time in university, Lord, that you've built her up so much, Father, that she can now stand on herself, Father, and that now she chose you, Father, and she just got baptized, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that you have so many adventures for her, Father, and that you just love her, Father. Thank you, Lord, that you stand behind her, Father, and in everything that she does and every choice that she makes, Father, you are there, Lord. And I bless every route that she's going to take, Lord, and I bless everything that she's going to run into, Lord. And I just thank you, Lord, that you would be with her and that you'd give her joy and peace and rest. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah, Lord, I thank you so much for Mateo, Lord. I just thank you, God, just for the gentleness and kindness that she carries, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jesus, just for the faithfulness that you've shown her, Lord Jesus, through her university experience, Father God. And I just thank you, God, Lord, that she may know, Lord, that you go before her, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that she may just continue to just to grow more with you, Father, Lord. I just see you and the Father just sitting at the table, and it's a big feast, and you're just enjoying the Father. So I just thank you, God, for that, Lord, that just for everything that she's learned about you, the connection that she's had with you, Lord Jesus, I thank you that it just becomes even stronger, and Lord, that she'll be able to spread that with other people, Lord Jesus, that people may come to know you because of her, Lord Jesus. So I just thank you, God, for that, Lord. I thank you for the people that you'll meet along her way, Lord Jesus, and I thank you, God, that you'll be a light and a blessing in their lives, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Lord, I thank you, God, for Linda, Lord. I thank you, Jesus, just for who she is, God. I thank you, Lord Jesus, because she's just so full of courage, God, so full of strength, Father, Lord, that just comes from you, Father, Lord. I thank you, God, Lord, that you just continue to reveal yourself to her, Lord Jesus. I thank you, God, Lord, that you'll be a woman of your word, Lord Jesus. I thank you, God, Lord, that she'll just be able to just share who you are, God, with boldness with other people, Lord Jesus. And I just thank you, God, just for an enjoyment, Lord, in the next season. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Can you stand with us?
Of love. only God who comes to save. And Jesus is the captain's king. So who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before me. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chain. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before me. So who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? No, nobody else. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord?
Curse of sin, he rules, he reigns with eyes ablaze. Heaven's hosts and angels sing, God all around us, servant king in praise. Holy is his name.
There is one
whose love has overcome the grief of death and the curse of sin. He reigns, he reigns with lies of blames. Heaven's hosts and angels sing, gathered around us, seven king in praise. Holy is his name. Heaven's sun was crashed for us. He bridged the chasm with his blood.
Son, for me.
Like a hurricane, I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so.
Beautiful now and now, your affections are.
just in the last 2 weeks, I think this idea of freedom in Galatians 5, it says it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. It's for freedom's sake that Christ has set us free. Therefore, stand firm and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Throw off that yoke of slavery this morning. Holy Spirit, come and remove the yoke of slavery from us this morning. You say further in verse 13, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one commandment: love your neighbors as yourself. And so may we walk by the Spirit. It says, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. You will not put on that yoke of slavery again. Later on, towards the end of chapter 5, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And I think often we think that that fruit is, if we're walking by the Spirit, is that is what we are able to give. And that is correct. But not only are we able to give of that fruit, but we are actually able to eat of that fruit ourselves. So we don't only, we're not only able to then love as we walk by the Spirit, but we're actually able to receive love. Right? And this morning I just felt in particular that peace is something that the Holy Spirit wants to give us this morning. That the peace of God that surpasses all understanding is the yoke that He wants to place on your shoulders this morning. In Matthew 11, He says, come to me, all those who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I will give you peace. Take upon yourselves my yoke, which is light. And so this morning, I really just feel that the Lord wants to give some of us peace here. So that's sort of what I felt to share. Kenny's gonna just listen.
Yeah. So I think we can just respond to that. So if you don't feel free today, if you're struggling now, we were singing, and you didn't feel that freedom and that God really loves you, then I want everyone just to close their eyes quickly. Then I want you to raise your hand. If you, what we sang now about Jesus is jealous of us and He loves us. And you actually, how I would explain it is, you just struggle to relax in God's presence. If you like that, then I just want you to raise your hand. If you struggle to relax in God's presence. Cool, then I see a few hands. So can I ask a favor? So the people sitting, can you keep your hands up? I hope I don't embarrass you. Then I want the people that stands around that person, there's a few hands, just to pray for that person. But I want, the only thing I want you to pray is just pray God's love over that person, because it's God's love that will set them free. So just keep your hands up. Just, you can open your eyes, look around you. Lay hands and just pray God's love over that, because it's God's love that really gives us freedom and makes us relax in His presence. Thank you, Jesus, that we can pray right now. Father, I pray that you come with your Holy Spirit and you shower them with your love. Father, thank you that I can just pray that, just feel like that. Done some sin that they worry about. They've done some sin in the past month or so recently, and they feel that that's keeping them away from your love, but that's a lie from the devil. Jesus, your love is greater than any sin, anything that the devil can do. Your love pursues them. I just pray your love over them right now in the name of Jesus. Thank you that right now you're touching those people and you doing something in their heart, and I pray that they'll really feel how they can just relax in your presence, like my kids can relax in my presence as a father, so they can just relax. They don't have to worry that they can't yet do the things that an adult can do. We can't yet do the things that God can do, but we're on a journey, and one day in heaven we'll be alive. like Jesus. Amen. Okay, then, thanks, band. That was awesome. Thanks for leading us in the presence. It's a great, great service that you do to us. And then it's my privilege just to call up the speaker. I met this guy in a queue going to a pub in Stellenbosch when I was still at high school. So our journey go a long way back. It was a great journey, but what I can say about it, it's God's grace that really comes out in this journey. The speaker is Johann. Snyman, I was in res with him. I know almost everything about him. We've cried together. We've done lots of things together. And his life is really a testimony of what God can do through his grace. He's one of the most excellent people that you'll ever meet. Everything he does 110%. Johann, we're looking forward to the great message from you.
Thanks, Kenny. No pressure after that intro. But yes, Kenny does know everything about me and maybe a little bit more. So it's a privilege for me to be here with you today. As Kenny said, my name is Johann. I've been married to Tara for almost 13 years. She's at the back there. We've got two boys. Aaron is 6 and Jonathan 3. They keep us on our toes. So we are in an interesting but amazing season of life, which I won't trade for anything in this world. But let me start off with praying first before we start talking about today's topic. Lord, I thank you, Father, that you are here in our midst. Where two or more gather in your name, you are here. We thank you, Father God, that where your spirit is, there's freedom, Lord. That you bring freedom, Lord, that you move mightily here, Father God, in this day, Father. Thank you that you go out before us, that you prepare the way for our hearts, Lord, Father, for this message. Thank you, Lord, that my words will fall to the ground, that your words will prevail. Thank you that your words do not return void, that they fulfill the purposes for which they sent forth, Lord, Father. We thank you, Father God, that your agenda will prevail, not mine, not anyone else's, Lord, but your agenda, in Jesus' name. Amen. So, Tian's word, that just happened in the first 1 minute. So, Tian's word was very much on par with what we're speaking about today. It was pretty much sweet spot what I'm talking about today, even the verse that he read from Matthew 11 or recited. That's the verse of the day, Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30. So thank you for that. Kenny, thank you for that prayer. So you guys basically covered 75% of the message. No, don't say sorry. You teed it up perfectly. So let me start off with a few questions. Who of you here feel stressed? I know it's a loaded question, it's the end of the year, but who of you feel stressed? Who of you feel slightly anxious? I do. Who of you feel constantly 24/7 hurried? That's me as well. Who of you feel just drained? Drained? Yes, I feel drained. And who of you feel that you can never get ahead of that to-do list? You tick off one thing, two things appear from nowhere. I don't know what it is. Spend more time on your to-do list and more things arrive on your to-do list. I don't know what it is, but it happens. So that's me. So many times you hear a message from someone who's completely attained complete and full victory on the topic that he or she is speaking about. Today that's not the case. Today I'm talking to you and with you in the trenches. I'm here alongside you. I'm 50% there knowing that I've got a problem, knowing that I can only rely on God to fix it. Because I am stretched beyond capacity and God is in process with me, telling me and showing me how I can realign my life and my lifestyle to his life and his lifestyle. So let me start again. Hello, my name is Johann, and I suffer from hurry sickness. And I believe some of you here also suffer from hurry sickness. Many of us are skimming over our life. We're just skimming along each and every day, just over the surface. That's what it feels like. It doesn't feel like you're getting ground. It doesn't feel like you're touching down anywhere, because you're just skimming along. So there's even a term that's been coined by futurist David Zach. It's called hyperliving. And that's me, guilty as charged, hyperliving. So how do I know that some of you here needs to hear this, that I need to hear it again? Because our oldest foe, most uncreative, non-original in the universe, tried everything this week to discredit me. I had the most horrendous week. I'm in investments. We're trying to close 3 deals at the moment. I was on my phone at 6 p.m. on a Friday night. It's burger night in our house on a Friday night. But I was busy trying to negotiate between 2-3 parties, looking at my wife through the window, seeing and feeling the fury through the window, and knowing that I'm in deep, deep trouble. But that was my week. Completely an effort by the enemy to discredit me. But it's amazing to be able to say, yes, that is right. I'm not worthy of actually sharing this message, because I'm in the trenches with you. But it's not about me, it's about God. All he needs is a broken, empty vessel, and that's what I can give him. And then the little time that I had to prep yesterday, well, I prepped the whole week, but to compile my notes, we decided to go to a friend's kid's birthday party in the northern suburbs. We live here in Claremont. Drove all the way there. We get there, and no one's there. Okay, look at the invite again. Oh, it's not at their house. It's at a third-party venue, neutral venue. We drive there, 20 minutes later, half an hour late for the party. We arrive, there's no cars there. We look at the invite again, wrong day. Okay, so that's 2-3 hours, okay, maybe not 3, but 2 hours gone that I could have used to just compile my notes. Earlier in the week, on Tuesday, my new laptop, it's a nice laptop. I bought it in March, or the company bought it for me in March. It's 6, 7, 8 months old. It fried completely. I could literally fry an egg on it. I actually wanted to run to Pick and Pay and try it, but I thought maybe I'll void my warranty. So I didn't do it, but I was super tempted. So the whole week I've been working with this backup laptop that's been working fairly okay. But once again, yesterday afternoon, eventually back from the party that wasn't a party, back at home trying to compile my notes, this laptop gives me blue screens every 5 minutes. I don't know who of you know the blue screen of death. I stared down the blue screen of death about 50 times yesterday afternoon. Eventually, I just started working on these units in front of me, and I just ditched the laptop. Sorry, Bill, and thanks, Steve, for that. So, and lastly, just to like try and completely put me out of my frame of mind, the Springboks lost against the English. Anyone is here from England, we love you, but I really dislike losing against you. I don't know if it's the way you celebrate, I don't know what it is, but I really dislike it. But bless the Welsh, because the other team that I really dislike losing against is Australia, and they beat Australia. So, not all is lost. Any case, so many times in life we think that life is better by addition. We feel like we need to add something. I need to add a new job. I need to add a bigger house. I need to add a newer car. I need to upgrade my wardrobe. If I can just add something, my life will be better. But that is a lie. It's mostly a lie. Most of the time, our life is made better by subtraction, by taking away unnecessary things and stuff that waste our time and that keep us away from firstly God and also the people who are important in our lives and the things and the calling that we've actually been called to. So today is about subtraction, it's not about addition. It's about thinking about your life and not thinking what you can add to it, but what you can subtract. Dallas Willard, he died in 2013, he was a Christian philosopher. He said the following about hurry. He said, hurry involves excessive haste or a state of urgency. It's associated with words such as hurl, hurdle, hurly-burly, and hurricane. It's a state of frantic effort one falls into in response to inadequacy, fear, and guilt. We should take it as our aim to live our lives entirely without hurry. We should form a clear intention to love without hurry, one day at a time, trying today. So Dallas Willard was the mentor of another guy called John Ortberg. Some of you might know John Ortberg, American author and pastor. And in the 90s, they had this telephone conversation. John phoned up Dallas and he said, "Dallas, I've got one question for you. What do I need to do to become the person I want to be?" And there was a long silence on the line. Apparently that was always the case with Dallas. And he said, "You must ruthlessly eliminate hurry from your life." Now, many of you have read John Mark's Coma, The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry. It is a word, I believe, for our generation. And there's a lot of authors now writing about it. There's another book called Sacred Pace. And even many years ago, a Japanese theologian wrote the book 3 Mile an Hour God. Apparently, that's the pace at which one walks, 3 mile an hour. And that's the pace we should actually be walking at with God, philosophically and practically speaking and theologically speaking. So John then said, "Okay, well, thank you, Dallas, but what else must I do? I must ruthlessly eliminate hurry, but what else should I do?" Once again, long silence, and then he said the following, "Dallas, there's nothing else. Hurry is the great enemy of spiritual life in our day. You must ruthlessly eliminate hurry from your life." Corrie ten Boom, many of you know her, she said, "If the devil can't make you sin, the devil will make you busy." The famous psychologist Carl Jung said, "Hurry is not of the devil, hurry is the devil." So how did we get here? In 200 BC, something called the sundial was developed. We had a Roman playwright moan about it, saying, "The gods should confound the man who invented this thing, who fragmented my day." That's 200 BC. Then in the 6th century, you've got the monks, and in the monastery, Saint Benedict, who organized the monastery around seven prayer times a day. And by the 12th century, they had developed a mechanical clock to muster the troops 7 times a day. And then most historians would agree that in 1370, in Cologne, Germany, when the first public clock tower was erected, the West's relationship to time was profoundly touched and changed from there on onwards. Because all of a sudden, life before was essentially agrarian rhythm. It was an agrarian rhythm between harvesting, between planting, summer, winter. There was no focus on exactitude. It was just life. Shorter days in winter, less productivity in winter, longer days in summer, a little bit more productive in summer, but that was it. But all of a sudden, artificial time was introduced and the 9-to-5 slog 365 days a week, 24/7, is what came to be, and we all know that very well. Then in 1879, Edison invented the light bulb. Do you guys know how long people used to sleep on average before the light bulb was invented? Almost 11 hours. So people were sleeping 11 hours a day. So we read about John Wesley, Charles Spurgeon, all these heroes of the faith getting up at 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning to pray, and I'm not taking anything away from them, but they did have 8 or 9 hours of sleep already behind them. If I get up at 3 in the morning, I usually have maybe 4 hours of sleep behind me. So it is different. In America currently, average amount of sleep people get 7 hours a night. So 4 hours less than in 1879. And then you had all these technological advances, cars, air cons, emails, takeaway. Instead of writing a letter, I send an email. 5 minutes later, here's my response. Now I need to do something again. That's the thing about email. The more email you do, the more email you do. And then in 2007, another watershed moment. Who can tell me what happened in 2007? The smartphone was invented. And the iPhone, to be exact. A small company called Apple, fairly unknown guy called Steve Jobs, introduced the iPhone in 2007. And all of a sudden, we had infinity in our front right pocket. All of a sudden, we could take out our phone whenever we bought. 77% of Americans admit to the fact that whenever they board in that first instance, they take out their phone and they start scrolling. I don't know what scrolling is. Scribbling. Any case, so a recent study found that people touch their phone about 2,617 times a day. They have on average 76 sessions a day and they spend on average 2.5 hours a day on their phone. So usually my weekly report comes in at about 2.5 to 3 hours, so I'm there pretty much average. This week, as I looked this morning, it came in at 4 hours. We'll put that down to me prepping on my phone. I hope that was the case for it being 4 hours this week. So in the 60s, the futurists all supposed and ventured out to say that by now we would be working 3-4 hours a day. And we'd be playing golf and doing nothing else because of technological advances. Yet we're more busy than any time in history because we filled it up with more. Because once again, we value busyness. It's a status symbol in our society. 50 years, 60 years ago, if you could lounge around at the country club and play golf, that was a status symbol. Today, you have to say you're busy. How do we? People ask you, how's it going? I'm busy, I'm so busy, I'm so busy. And so we say it by default. I say it. I try not to say it, since God's been in process with me on this, but I still find myself saying this. We are more busy than in any other time in history, yet we are more miserable than any other time in history as a society. Gandhi perhaps had a point when he said that there's more to life than simply increasing its speed. So what is hurry sickness? A quick definition. It's a behavior pattern characterized by continual rushing and anxiousness. Another cardiologist 50 years ago said that it's a harrying sense of time urgency, and he saw that in most of his type A patients who were at risk of heart disease, they had this common denominator, a harrying sense of time urgency. So how do you know, if you're still wondering whether you have it or not, how do you know that you have it? Okay, shopping queues. There's a queue, pick and pay, which one do you choose? Do you go for the longest queue or do you go for the shortest queue? Who goes for the longest queue? You need to come and lay hands on all of us at the end of this sermon. Most of us go for the shortest queue. I end up going left, right, two left, five right, and I end up spending more time there, but I feel that I'm moving forward. Red light, drive your car, get to a red light, two lanes, which lane do you pick? The lane with the fewest amount of cars ahead of you. That's the one I pick. Multitasking, you're multitasking, multitasking, and then you just forget a task. You just completely forget it. Forget what you were busy with. Hurry sickness. And then my favorite, this is my ultimate favorite, it's also the city of Cape Town's ultimate favorite. There's two lanes converging into one, just after a red light or stop street. And I'm not an engineer, but I don't know how you can, Kenny, maybe you can tell me later, how you can spend billions to put an on-ramp, an M5 on-ramp, onto the M2, and in the last 100 meters or 200 meters, you decide two lanes, too much, we'll make it one lane. Every morning I get there, my Christian testimony is tested, and I know Etienne said here last week that we need to look at that driver in the other car and bless them. Hi there, image bearer of God, I love you. I struggle with that. I'm already angry when I see those two lanes converging into one. I'm already angry at everyone next to me, behind me, and in front of me, because someone's going to push in front of me. Shouldn't be like that, but that is hurry sickness. What other symptoms are there? Irritability. Not irritability with a colleague or distant neighbor or cousin. Irritability with the people you love most. Irritability with your spouse. Irritability with your kids. Irritability with your parents. Hypersensitivity. Being one comment away from being offended yet again. The world is against me, everyone hates me, proven again by that one comment. Restlessness, can't sit still. Go to a restaurant with my spouse, she goes to the loo, in 5 minutes I can't just sit there, I'm restless, I need to start scrolling through my phone, look at my emails. Workaholism. See, the drugs of choice in Western society is accumulation and accomplishment. And what that leads to is sunset fatigue. So by the time you get home after work, or by the time you walk out of your work from home office these days, you are tired. You've got nothing left to give to your spouse, nothing left to give to your friends, your kids, your parents, yourself, to God, nothing. Sunset fatigue, it's a real thing. Emotional numbness, you're just stunted, blunted emotionally. Nothing can really do anything to you. You're not crying, you're not laughing, you're not doing anything. Out of order priorities, you're busy with the urgent. You're not busy with the important. You know what is important, but there's burning platforms all around you, and all you're doing is going from the one burning platform to the other burning platform, dousing each and every fire that you see. Lack of bodily care. Kenny doesn't have this problem. He's riding 200 Ks next week in a bicycle race. So if he hasn't been taking care the last few weeks, then good luck, Kenny. for next week. We'll think of you. Escapist behavior. Anyone know of Netflix and chill? So instead of dealing with a problem, I'm just going to evacuate this life and go live in an imaginary life for a few hours. I don't know where I read it, but the average person on Netflix spends 12 hours to get through one day. They can get through a 12-hour season in one day. Average person, so that's the best, that's the top performers, if you can call them top performers. The average person spends 4 or 5 days to go through an entire season. They spoke to Reed Hastings about other companies starting streaming channels, whether or not he's worried about them. He didn't say he's worried about them. He said our biggest competitor is sleep. Not another company and another streaming service, sleep. So why do we chase after all of this in vain? The author of Ecclesiastes many, many moons ago said that it's all in vain. We're chasing the wind. But why do we do it? John Ortberg had a saying, which, it's not nice to read it because it means I need to delve deeper than my schedule. He said, hurry is not just a disordered schedule, it's a disordered heart. So if you're hurrying, you can start with your schedule, but you need to address something bigger. It means I need to address something deeper and bigger than my schedule, and that's my heart. So if I know this, if I'm constantly plagued by anxiety, stress, why am I doing this? Why am I on this treadmill? Why do I not get off this treadmill? Well, there's something called FOMO, fear of missing out. So I don't want to be the only one that didn't make the news feed on Facebook, the photo of everyone being at XYZ restaurant. I don't have time, I'm tired. I haven't spent time with my family this week, but I'm going for that reunion with classmates because I don't want to be the one that wasn't there the next day. We are afraid of missing out. The other one is YOLO. You only live once, sleep when you're dead, Red Bull, all those things. It only gets you thus far. There is a problem in trying to pack in everything and trying to experience everything, everyone, every place. It cannot be done. We have an infinite soul, an infinite desire, but we've got a finite soul. Our spirit is eternal, but we've got a finite soul, infinite desire, and we'll get to that a little bit later. Insecurity, inferiority. So I'm saying yes to just another thing because I need to prove myself. I haven't accomplished something in the last 6 months, the last 9 months. I define myself for my accomplishments, and I need to now go and prove myself. So I'm not going to say no. I will say yes because I'm insecure. Fear of failure. I will work harder. I will work longer hours because I'm afraid of failing. And boredom with the mundanity of life. We have forgotten how to get bored. Boredom is fantastic. That's where creative juices and energy really flows. If you're bored, that's when you get some weird idea that you've actually been thinking about and it just gets dropped, either by God or just like randomly, just a thought that's been there. But it doesn't get the time to actually flourish when we're busy. So we need to give boredom a little bit higher credit. So that brings us to our scripture reading. We know that someone once said that what good is it for someone to gain the world but to lose their soul? And this is what many of us, myself included, forget so quickly and easily. We want to try and gain something more, but we lose our soul. So the scripture reading, Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30. Tian, thanks for the prophetic word. So in the ESV version, it says the following. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now I know 3/4 of you are saying and thinking, being very polite, not saying it, but thinking, it's not light, it's not easy. I am stressed, I don't have that inner peace. What is going on? This is false advertising. Let's get to the Message version, Eugene Peterson's version. Are you tired, worn out, burnt out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. That should have been my sermon title. The unforced rhythms of grace. How good is that? I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. So why is Jesus talking about a yoke? Why is he talking about some agrarian piece of equipment? Because in that day and age, every single rabbi had a yoke. So he wasn't unique in the sense that he had a yoke. He was unique in the sense that his yoke was easy. What was a yoke? A yoke was the way in which the rabbi read the Torah and the way in which he lived life. The way in which he experienced the human condition by way of his lifestyle. The other thing a rabbi had was apprentices. So we are called to be Jesus' apprentices. We're not called to just follow his ideas. That's just theology. We're not called to follow his list of do's and don'ts. That's just ethics. See, our life is a byproduct of our lifestyle. What is our life? It's our experience of the human condition. What is a lifestyle? It's your rhythms and your habits. So your experience of the human condition is a byproduct of your rhythms and your habits. But most of us wonder, why do I not feel at ease? Why do I not feel inner peace? This yoke doesn't feel easy. But this is the crux. We only achieve inner peace when our schedule aligns with our values. So what do we see? We see the life of Jesus. We aspire to his values. We like his values. We want to live out those values. We really like them. But we don't want to live the lifestyle. Or we forget that there's a lifestyle to be lived that will lead to that life and that values system. It's like, you can't go run the comrades if you don't put in the lifestyle. Kenny can't go ride the DC next week, 200 kilometers, if he hasn't lived the lifestyle of a cyclist in between work and three kids going to four, and I don't even know, is it four going to five? I'm like, there's a lot of movement there. But also between houses, but he's fitting in the lifestyle of a cyclist there, yeah, because he needs to go and ride 200 kilometers. He can't do that if he just aspired to being a cyclist and he read about Eddie Merckx and read about this champion and Bradley Wiggins. He can read all he wants about it. He's not going to be able to ride 200 kilometers if he doesn't put in the lifestyle. So we simply cannot just follow Jesus' values and expect to live a joyous life, a content life, an inner peaceful life. We need to adopt his schedule. So Frederick Dale Bruner, he's a top scholar on the Gospel of Matthew. He said the following about the paradox of an easy yoke. He said, a yoke is a work instrument. Thus, when Jesus offers a yoke, he offers what we might think tired workers need least. They need a mattress or a vacation, not a yoke. But Jesus realizes that the most restful give he can give the tired is a new way to carry life, a fresh way to bear responsibilities. Realism sees that life is a succession of burdens. We cannot get away from them. Thus, instead of offering escape, Jesus offers equipment. Jesus means that his obedience to his Sermon on the Mount, his yoke, his way of teaching, his way of experiencing the life condition, the human condition, will develop in us a balance and a way of carrying life that will give more rest than the way we have been living. So life is hard. An easy life is not an option, but an easy yoke is an option. Jesus had things to do. He was productive. It wasn't that he wasn't lazy. He was productive. He had things to do, but he was never hurried. He had margin in his life. What is margin? It's the difference between your limit and your load. So if you load yourself up to your limit, you have no margin. If your load equals your limit, then any unforeseen event, any interruption in your day throws you off course. It's a proverbial straw that broke the camel's back. Every single interruption. If your life is to the T, run to the T, minute to minute, then one accident ahead of you on the N1 and you having to stop there for 30 minutes throws your entire day out. It throws you into a state of anxiety and stress immediately. Why? Because you've got zero margin. You need to build in margin between your limit and your load. There's a principle called leaning that we don't have time to go into today, but essentially it is limiting your productivity in order to leave margin not just so you find rest and inner peace, but that those around you, living around you, can feed off of that which you left behind. So why is it important to master this? Dallas Willard said that the devil majors in three things: noise, hurry, and crowds. So the devil wants to get you in crowds, in noise, and have you hurrying around. Then at least a few times a day, a week, a month, you need to remove yourself from noise, hurry, and crowds. See, love, joy, and peace are incompatible with hurry. Love is patient. That's the first descriptor that Paul gives to love. It's patient. Every single parent here, every single spouse, every single partner here knows that love is patient. Love cannot be hurried. But hurry and love is oil and water. The late Japanese theologian Kosuke Koyami, in his book, 3 Mile an Hour God, that I spoke about earlier, said God walks slowly because he is love. Love has its speed, and it's an inner speed. It's slow, yet it is Lord over all other speeds. Walter Adams, spiritual director to C.S. Lewis, said that to walk with Jesus is to walk with a slow, unhurried pace. Hurry is the death of prayer and only impedes and spoils our works, our work. It never advances it. See, spirituality is simple. We over-spiritualize this. But spirituality, what is it? It is being able to receive love from God and then to be able to be a conduit that then passes that love on to the people around us. Can you receive love from God? Can you pass it on to those around you? Can you pass His love on to those around you? That is spirituality. In a state of hurry and anxiety, you're not going to be able to do that. I can't receive love if I'm in a hurry, if I'm anxious. I can't give it, especially can't give it. If I'm in a hurry, I'm anxious, I'm frustrated, I'm stressed. So we need to employ a few practices, spiritual practices, like a trellis. What's the function of a trellis? It's in a vineyard, it's not to make the vine stand in a straight line. It's to give them space so that they can grow, so that they can bear much fruit. And it's amazing to see God speaking about, Jesus speaking about much fruit, not more fruit. It's not about more, much. Much is innumerable. You're supposed to bear much fruit, not more fruit, not many fruit, not more, much fruit, innumerable. But we have to then live the lifestyle. We have to adapt our schedule. So what can we do? There are four things that we can do. By the way, time, more time is not a solution. More time is never the solution. It's a reprioritization of our time. Our time is our life, and our attention is the doorway to our hearts. What do we give our time and attention to? So silence and solitude. This was the way of Jesus. So Duncan spoke about it a few weeks ago. Twice, in very pivotal moments in Jesus' life and ministry, he went and he spent time alone before he chose the disciples and before he was crucified. But it was his lifestyle. If you read in Luke, you would see that at least nine times it's mentioned that he goes to a place of silence and solitude. The more famous he became, the more busy he became, the more he went and he sought silence and solitude. We're usually the other way around. The busier we get, the more important and famous we feel we get, the more we're there for everyone. But this was a part of his natural rhythm. We read about the fact that the Holy Spirit led him into the desert after he was baptized. That word desert, the Greek word eremos, actually doesn't mean desert necessarily. It means a deserted place, a place of solitude, a quiet place. We think of it as a place of weakness because after 40 days in the desert, Jesus was so weak that he was attacked by the devil. No, it's a place of strength. After 40 days of silence and solitude, spending it with his Father, he had the fortitude to withstand what the enemy threw at him. So we need to start thinking of the eremos as a place of strength, not a place of weakness. Silence, it's twofold. It's external and it's internal. The external one is easy, although we struggle with that. We always have our earpods in, listening to another podcast, going there, cycling. I can't just cycle and just be. I need to listen to another podcast. I'm 5 podcasts behind. How they built this, etc. So silence, external, shut it down. Internal silence, that'll take a while. Because you're going to find, when you sit down long enough, not even long enough these days, a few seconds, internal noise will come. But you have to sit it out. You have to remove the wheat from the chaff. It takes time. And then solitude is not isolation. Solitude is a place of safety. Isolation is a place of danger. Solitude is a place of engaging. isolation is a place of escape. And then everyone's talking about mindfulness, mindfulness, mindfulness. Mindfulness is silence and solitude for a secular society. It's just missing the best part, Jesus. See, the devil doesn't want us to come into a place of silence and solitude. C.S. Lewis, in his famous book, The Screwtape Letters, I don't know if you have read The Screwtape Letters, amazing book. It's a dialogue by way of letter between the head demon for a specific region and his little minions. So in this book then, Screwtape, the head demon, rails against silence as a danger to their cause. And their cause was to just get every single Christian off the path and to the kingdom of hell. He also calls the devil's realm the kingdom of noise. And he said in the book, we will make the whole universe a noise in the end. So if the devil wants us to be surrounded by noise, crowds, and hurry, we need to run the opposite direction. Henry Nouwen said the following, without solitude, it's virtually impossible to live a spiritual life. We do not take the spiritual life seriously if we do not set aside time for God, to be with God, and to listen to Him. So the quiet place, the eremos, a place of strength, let's bring it back. Secondly, Sabbath. Sabbath is a way to mitigate against the restlessness of our culture, the condition of our humanity at present. We don't Sabbath because the work is finished, we Sabbath because the work will never be finished. What is it? Sabbath, the word, is a Hebrew word, Shabbat. It means to stop. Not to slow down, it means to stop. Stop working, stop worrying, stop wanting. Stop long enough so that you can start to wonder again, so that you can start to delight, not just primarily in God, but not just that, the nice and beautiful things in this world, the outdoors, your family, your relationships. You need to get a place, come to a place of delight and wonder, but you can't get to a place of delight and wonder if you don't stop. Once you stop, the wonder will return. The wonder and the delight in your Father, your Heavenly Father, and the delight of just enjoying what He has given you, your relationships, things you can do, running in the mountain, whatever it is. It's a time to rest and worship. It's also a time to resist. Why do I say that? You see that in Deuteronomy 5, when the commandment is given a second time, by the way, this is the only spiritual discipline that made it into the Ten Commandments. If you divide the Ten Commandments up as a pie chart, it would take up more than 30% of the pie chart. It's also the only commandment that has a why. So it's pretty important. So why does God need to command us? Because our human nature is to hurry, okay? So secondly, in the second time that this was given, the first time in Exodus, the basis was Genesis, the rest and worship of God. In Deuteronomy, the basis was Exodus. What happened in Exodus? The story is about the Israelites being in slavery. They were enslaved. And it says the following. Says a lot of things. Observe the Sabbath day. By the way, we observe Christmas, we observe Passover, Easter. It means you prepare for it. It means that there are things you do leading up to it. In Exodus, it said, remember the Sabbath. Here it's observe, so prepare for it. To keep it holy as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter or your male servant or your female servant or your ox or your donkey or any of your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates, that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well as you. You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. So the Sabbath day is also an act of resistance. That's what Walter Brueggemann said. It's an act of resistance. Egypt was an economy of more, 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 a consumeristic economy. They built massive buildings to store their excess stuff. Those buildings we now call pyramids. Storage business is alive and well and kicking globally. In America, it's a $38 billion industry, comprising 2.3 billion square feet, which means that every single American can go stay in a storage unit and they'll have 7 square feet to themselves. This is just America. That's an indictment on our way of living and our consumeristic mindset that we have to build these places, to put away stuff that we forget about, that we don't know about even more, that we never use. It's different to use it in between two moves. I've done that. So if you go down my bank accounts, you'll see storage essay there. But if we go there to put yachts and toys and things we never use, or what we're sentimental about, that could be life-giving to someone else, but we just store it there. It's not broken, but we want something new. Something is wrong with that picture. It was also an economy of slavery. And we think slavery is something of the past. There are at least 28 million slaves in the world today. That is more than what that was ever trafficked in the transcontinental slave trade in the 18th century. There are more slaves today. They are working 7 days a week, many of them, to give you the shirt, the kicks, and the car that you're driving. So what if we can, as an act of resistance, one day a week, just stop? What if Takealot can stop their website, just disengage it for a day? What if Amazon can disengage it? What if our shops owners can close their shops? Chick-fil-A is doing it in America. They get a lot of flack for it, and they get mocked. But what if the whole of society can stop feeding the beast one day a week? If we can do that, we'll make a difference. Those people working 7 days a week might be able to work one day less, might be able to spend time with family, might be able to recuperate. So the last time that humanity tried to move away from the seven-day working week was in the French Revolution, where they instituted a 10-day working week. Suicide rates went up, it skyrocketed, the economy crashed, and productivity went down. Lots of studies have shown that 50 to 55 hours is the max amount of hours a person can work before their productivity drops each week. If you do the sums, that's about a 6-day working week, not a 7-day or 10-day working week. But coming back to the resistance, it's something that we can do. You can do it at home. Just say no. It's not about, I don't believe it's about sitting and doing nothing. I believe it's a time where you sit long enough, you stop long enough, to start taking delight in your Father. You start worshiping Him, you rest. But it's also time to engage with your friends, with your family, without an agenda. It's time to go climb Lion's Head, just to spend time in the great outdoors, something beautiful, enjoying something beautiful that God has given you. Thirdly, simplicity. Say no more often. We need to know that every yes is a thousand no's. There's an opportunity cost. We need to understand that no is a complete sentence. You don't have to feel guilty about saying no. Because I am in investments, I have to quote Warren Buffett at least once every single time I speak. And he said, the only difference between great and good people are that great people say no more often. So yes, he was speaking about material success, but I think this translates 100% to spiritual health and inner peace. We need to say no more often. An author of the book, The Mise of Guys, said that by the age of 21, most American males have spent 10,000 hours playing video games. Most of you know the 10,000 hour rule. If you spend 10,000 hours on any one topic, you'll probably become an expert at it. So these guys played a little bit less Call of Duty. They could have been experts at a lot more things, productive things, life-giving things at the age of 21. So we need to be less worried about doing things and less worry about owning things. The world says constantly, what more can I add, what more can I get? As apprentices of Jesus, we need to be willing and we need to be heard saying frequently, how can I live with less? How can I do less? Not contribute, but less hurry. We need to understand that the drive to possess is an engine for hurry. The drive to possess more is an engine for hurry. Not only does that item or toy cost you money, it costs you time. And not only the time that you work to get that money, because hopefully you saved up and you didn't use your credit card for it, because that's a whole other sermon, but the time to maintain that toy afterwards, the time to clean it, the time to look after it. Less time equals more hurry. And Jesus said that life doesn't consist in an abundance of possessions. He said in Matthew 6:25, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. It's not life more than food and the body more than clothing. See, we worry about what we worship. We worry about what we worship. What are you worrying about? What am I worrying about? We need to know that we worry about what we worship. Henry David Thoreau, he was a naturalist, philosopher in America in the 19th century. He spent 2 years in the wilderness on his own. He was a wealthy bachelor, so more doable for him than for a few of us. But he spent time there. He wrote a book called Walden about his experience, and he said the following: simplicity, simplicity, simplicity. I say, let your affairs be as two or three and not 100 or 1,000. Instead of a million, count 6 and keep your accounts on your thumbnail. Why should we live with such hurry and waste of life? St. Francis de Sales, Bishop of Geneva, said, in everything, love simplicity. Richard Foster said, a carefree unconcern for possessions marks life in the kingdom. God isn't against stuff. God isn't against you owning things. But if he doesn't want you to own that thing at that point in time, do you really want to own it? So go and inquire from him whether the stuff on your list should be on your list. Lastly, slowing down, aka know your limits. We are made in the image of Christ, image of God, but we're also made from dust. So we're made in the image of God. It talks to our potential. It speaks to our potential. We are made from dust. It speaks to our limitations. We are the original biodegradable containers. It's not my line. I wish it was my line, and I hope you got it, but it's pretty good. We are limited by our body. Not all of us are Eric Etzebet. I'm not. Not all of us are Albert Einstein. We're limited by our mind, by our giftings, our personality, our family setup, our socioeconomic background, our education, our career, our seasons of life. I'm way more limited now than I was as a bachelor, before I got married, before I had kids. Our lifespan, the average life expectancy globally is about 71 years. It's not a long time. And we're limited by God's call on our life. So we think that God's call, many times, I catch myself thinking God's call on my life is limitless. It's so amazing, it's limitless, but actually God's call on your life has limits. Peter Cesare said the following. He said, we find God's will for our lives in our limitations. Karl Rahner, one of the most important Catholic theologians of the 20th century, said the following. In the torment of the insufficiency of everything attainable, we learn that ultimately in this world, there is no finished symphony. There's no finished symphony, and this is what we need to understand. We've got infinite desire, we've got a finite soul. Mathematically, infinite desire minus a finite soul equals restlessness. It's the human condition. There's only one way to address this restlessness and get inner peace. It's to meet up with Jesus and to adopt his schedule. St. Augustine, Bishop of Hippo, said the following at the time of the fall of the Roman Empire. He said, you have made us for yourself, and our heart is restless until it rests in you. Dallas Willard said the following, desire is infinitely, partly because we were made by God, made for God, made to need God, and made to run on God. We can be satisfied only by the one who is infinite, eternal, and able to supply all our needs. We are only at home in God. When we fall away from God, the desire for the infinite remains, but is displaced upon things that will certainly lead to destruction. So we need to slow down our body, we need to slow down our life. I'll end with two stories. Many years ago, a few hundred years ago, there was a British traveler who arrived in Africa. He arrived in a town and he wanted to travel to another town overland. So he got porters, local guys, to help him carry all the stuff from the one town to the other town. After a harrowing day of traveling and a fitful night of sleep, they woke up early morning, he woke up early morning, and he wanted to cajole everyone out of their beds to start walking, because he had a schedule. He had a place to be, and he wanted to get there fast. But they refused to. He bribed them, he pleaded with them. Eventually, he got it out of them. Why were they unwilling to move and get up? Because they were waiting for their souls to catch up to their bodies. How many of us are waiting for our souls, even unknowingly, to catch up to our bodies? How many of us are not allowing our souls to ever catch up to our bodies? Slow down your body, slow down your mind. We are whole people. Our endeavors following Jesus should be whole people endeavors, body, mind, and soul. Don't forget that. Don't be so super spiritual that you just focus on that and then wonder why mentally and physically you're falling apart. We are whole people. Last story, Stephen De Silva. He's the CFO at Bethel. CPA, he wrote a book, good book about money, stewardship, possessions. And that's actually Randy Alcorn's title, but it's not that book. So he said he had a dream once. He had his own auditing firm. He was working for the church. He had this dream in which he was working on his laptop, battling away at Excel. For those of you who spend a lot of time in Excel, life in Excel, he was battling it away. He was completely mastering it. He was on the phone explaining something to a client, helping them solve a problem. And in came one of the interns at Bethel asking him a problem, a question, and he solved that problem whilst that person was there, whilst he was on his spreadsheet, whilst he was helping his client. And he felt himself standing next to God, looking at all of this, and he felt proud. He felt, look at me, I'm so productive. I am doing what God's called me to do. I'm not lazy. I'm putting my bread on the water. And he just felt God looking at him. He said, he felt saying to God, look at me, Papa. And then, what did he feel God tell him in that dream? Not well done, my beloved son. He said, this is not from me. This is not from me. See, we fill our schedules, we live Johann-sized lives instead of living a God-sized life. Most of the time, the God-sized life for me is much smaller than my Johann-sized life. My Johann-sized life is bigger because of my insecurities, my inferiorities, my ambition, my greed, my ineptitude at being willing to be bored. So we need to live God-sized lives. And most of us will get there not by adding more, but by subtracting more. Let's stand. Kenny and Tian will do a salvation altar call just now, but I think whilst we're on this now, I would like to just give an opportunity for anyone, and Kenny and Tian, you can come up. Anyone that feels anxious, hurried, drained, anyone that feels that I've been chasing the values of God but not his schedule, I want you just to raise your hand so we can pray for you. Depending on how many there are, I might ask you to just come to the front. Okay. So based on that, maybe can you guys come to the front? Kenny, Tian, any other leaders? See if you guys can... We'll pray a general prayer, and if whilst I pray, you can just get the oil and lay hands on, please, Kenny, Tian, Sifa. Lord, we thank you that we can lift up everyone here today, everyone in the front, Father God, to you, Lord Father. We thank you, Father God, that you love each and every one of them, Father God. We thank you, Father God, that you have made them in your image, Lord Father. We thank you, Father God, for all the potential they have, Lord Father, but also for the limitations, Lord Father. We thank you, Father God, that you enable them to embrace those limitations, to learn how to live with them, and to really enjoy it, Father. Enjoy the limitation. Enjoy the fact that we are not everyone for everything, everywhere, that we can rely on you as God our Father, Lord. Thank you, Father God, that you help each and every one of us here, Lord Father, to adopt not just your values, Lord Father, not just your ideas.